Very nice, even small, but very nice week. And I enjoyed, even if I was, and I am still not very good. I got a cold in Italy. It's completely crazy to get a cold in Italy. But and I am not still, I am still not very good. I have a very funny story that I came to the doctor here in Rio, and the doctor asked me age. And when I said, she said to me, "Oh, you don't seem this age." So I was very happy. And then I came back with the metro. I took metro in Cinelandia till Flamengo. And when I entered in the metro, there was a young guy, maybe he was 30, 20, something like that. And immediately when I entered in the metro, he stand up and he let me his place. So it was two very different viewpoints, and I don't know the one I prefer. So very funny. What I will say today, it's also a very interesting story. In fact, some years ago, I gave a course in a week, in the week mathematical in UNESP in San José de Rio Preto, with Nguyen Thibi Stuy, and we gave a course with two parts, one on Euler characteristic and one on Poincaré-Hopf theorem. And we wrote these two, and on the Poincaré-Hopf theorem, we gave a proof, which is quite not original, because it comes from Marie-Hélène Schwarz. But the proof that you can see the most easily in the books is from Milnor. And Milnor uses, in fact, he did this the same year than Marie-Hélène Schwarz. Both of them, the idea of radial extension. But Milnor, he makes radial extension only for vector fields with index 1. And he was able to do that only with vector fields with index 1. So if he has any vector field, he is obliged to decompose in a number singular points with index 1, and then he can work. But with Marie-Hélène Schwarz, you go directly. With any index, you can do that. And it's funny that that was the same year, both of them. But Marie-Hélène Schwarz made for any index and also for singular varieties. And Milnor is for smooth surface. So that is one point. And in fact, this course we publish, I think it's already published, but I have not received it, in a Revista Electronica da UNESP. This proof of Poincaré-Hopf theorem. And we wanted to publish the proof of Euler characteristic in Mathematica Universitaria. So we send it, because we use the Cauchy method for this. And we made for the sphere, we made for the torus, which was original, because we have never seen this for the torus. And the referee denied. And he said that it's impossible to use the Cauchy method to prove the Euler formula. And I was aware of a paper by Alan Lima in Mathematica Universitaria number 1, where he was giving things, but I was not aware of the second paper of Alan Lima. And in the second paper of Alan Lima, he says something, unfortunately, even very important person can make mistake. And you will see, Alan Lima says that it is impossible to prove Euler formula using the Cauchy method. And that we need a more modern result in order to do that. And so we were not happy, of course. And he said also that it is impossible to do for the tourists. Okay. So we are not happy and we worked. And this is the result of our work. And this is an elementary proof of the Euler formula using only the Cauchy method. Okay, so this was introduction. Well, a little of history maybe. You know very well, but you know that Pythagoras already were knowing the three first. Well, I have to push somewhere. I don't know where. Here? Yes. The three first. The three first examples, the tetrahedra, hectahedra, and octahedra. And Plato extended, and it's Plato who described the five regular tetra. Oh my God! Sorry, I am not very good. And so he gave the five, and this is from Plato. Archimedes is here. Why? Because I will not come back in the following, but Archimedes, some people say that Archimedes was already knowing the Euler formula. I tried to find, I did not find any proof of this, so I don't know. We don't know, but some people say that Euler formula was known by Archimedes. In history, the first important result is from Descartes. And this is the theorem, I insist. This is the theorem. Descartes shows that if you take any of these five elements, if you take one, for example, the dodecahedron, you take the sum of all angles for all faces, then if you take as a unity the right angle, then the sum of all these angles is 4 times the number of vertices minus 2. And this is a very nice result from Descartes. That is not well known, and it's a pity because it's very nice, and it's not so difficult to prove. And Descartes shown this around 1640. The problem is that Descartes wrote this in a manuscript. He gave the manuscript to Leibniz. Leibniz was in Stockholm at that time. And there is also a funny story here that Leibniz put the manuscript, as you do, when you receive a lot of manuscript, you put on the table, and then you have a lot of papers that you want to read, and you don't succeed to read the paper, and Leibniz took the manuscript of Descartes and he did not read immediately. It was accumulated with other manuscripts. And when Leibniz died, the manuscript of Descartes has been given to the French embassy in Stockholm. And the French ambassador came to Paris and he put in a box the manuscript of Descartes. And when he arrived in Paris, the box fell down in the river, in the Seine. And it was, people thought it was lost, but fortunately they succeeded to recover the box. And this theorem is effectively in this manuscript. Some people say that, in fact, before that. So Euler gave the formula, this famous formula, in 1751, in a letter to a friend, Goldbach. And he wrote the formula. The fact that if you take any triangulation of the sphere with n0 vertices, n1 edges, and n2 triangles, then the alternative sum is 2. That you know very well. Okay. So this was in a formula. And then he gave a proof 2 years later, but the proof is not correct. The proof is not going well. There is some mistake in the proof, but that was a tentative. The first thing is that it is easy, and you can do as an exercise, it's very easy, to show that the Descartes theorem proves the Euler formula. So it's a reason for which some people say that Descartes is the first to prove the Euler formula. In fact, the first complete proof has been given by Legendre in 1794. And Legendre uses the Descartes. In fact, the proof of Legendre is more or less to prove that the theorem implies the formula. But Legendre uses the polar, the dual polyhedra. You replace each vertex by the face and reciprocally. And then you have the dual polyhedra. And Legendre uses the dual polyhedra, but he proves this. So Legendre proves the Euler formula. So I don't want to make controversies and discussion, but in fact, the first proof we can say either by Descartes or by Legendre. But the first proof is not by Euler. And then a combinatorial proof has been given by Cauchy in 1811. And this is a proof that we will see now, if we have time, because if I speak like that. But there are two lectures which vanish, so I can speak during 6 hours. Okay, so this is a fact of history. And I will give you the Cauchy proof. And we will see why people say that Cauchy proof is not going on. Okay? The Cauchy proof is quite easy to understand. You take a polyhedra representing a triangulation of the sphere, you can imagine, one of the previous ones that you have seen. And the first step is to remove an open triangle. So this is a contribution to N2. N2 is a number of triangles, okay? So you remove a triangle. This makes a hole in the polyhedra. And you will extend this hole in such a way that the alternative sum N0 minus N1 plus N2 remains unchanged. So you extend, but without changing the alternative sum. Okay? So in fact, and you do that with two operations. The first operation is the following. So B is a removed triangle. Okay? And I take another triangle such that there is an edge common with B and this sigma. So I will extend the hole to include sigma in the hole. Okay. What I do, I take out an edge, I take out a triangle, N1, N2. But N0 minus N1 plus N2 does not change because N0 is 1, N1 is 1, and N2 is 1. Okay? So if you extend, you don't change. So you have now a new hole, and you did not change the alternative sum. And you continue. You can extend here by this one, sigma with tau, which is in common, edge in common. And so you extend the B, and for the same reason, the sum is not changed. And you continue. You can take that one, for example. Okay? Remember that the edge, the boundary of the edge, does not belong to the edge. It belongs to the rest of the polyhedra. Okay? And you continue. So you have now a new hole, which is like that. And you have a new situation. So this is operation 2, defined by Cauchy. You have a new situation. You see that now you have a simplex, a triangle, which has in a boundary, in common boundary, two edges with the hole, and also a vertex. Okay? And I want to include this sigma in the hole as well. So if I do that, I will include a vertex, one vertex, two edges, and one triangle. One vertex, two edges, one triangle. Alternative sum is the same, zero. Okay? So if you include this triangle by this operation 2 of Cauchy, you can extend your hole, and so on. And you continue. either by operation one, either by operation two. You extend, you extend, you extend. At the end, what you have is, according to Cauchy, at the end, it remains only one triangle because you take everything out, and there will be at the end only one triangle. Only one triangle has three vertices, three edges, one triangle. So n0 minus n1 plus n2 is 1. Okay? But don't forget that at the beginning, you take out one triangle, which was also 1. So 1 plus 1 is 2, and that's it. And that is the proof by Cauchy of the Euler formula, which is completely combinatorial, completely without anything of angles, of geometry. It's very combinatorial. Okay? Well, but the controversy comes from people, and I will show you why there is a controversy. So take the following picture, and then this hole, B. And you extend the hole with operation 1 and 2 by Cauchy. I will go fast, but I will use only operation 1 and operation 2. You can verify. Up. Now I have a simplex sigma and 2. I have two edges. And if I include this sigma in the hole, I will include two edges and one triangle. That's it. So the sum, alternative sum, change. Okay? So I cannot do the two operations by Cauchy does not give the result here. So that's the problem. And the problem was given by Lakatos. I don't know if you know this book by Lakatos. Imre Lakatos in his book. He's more philosophical than more. I don't like this. Many people like this book, but I don't. And the way I don't, you will understand very well. Because this book says that you can extension the whole, you can find situations which were not foreseen by Cauchy. And in fact, this situation here, you see very well that you include this sigma, you disconnect the rest. And this is the situation, disconnecting the rest. And Elon Lima, I said at the beginning in his book, in a paper in Mathematica Universitaria, he says, Cauchy method does not work, and the proof is given by Lakatos. And he gives four examples where you cannot extend. This is exactly the example we had just before, okay? But you have also these two examples where if you include in the hole the pink triangle, then alternative sum does not change. It changes, okay? And it's very interesting, and I don't know why Elon Lima gives also this example, but this example is good. It's good. If you include this sigma, you include two vertices, you include three edges, and one triangle. So alternative sum does not change. So I don't know why he makes this also this mistake here. And Elon Lima says, it is in Portuguese, but says, we cannot obtain an elementary proof of the Euler theorem with the hypothesis of P homeomorphic to a sphere, as these two books here. And these two books, they copy the Cauchy method. So this is exactly the Cauchy method. And Elon Lima says that it's not possible. So it's I am very unhappy that Elon Lima is not still alive, because I would be very, very happy to show to him that in fact, it works, so it's a pity. And even if what I am doing is showing that Elon Lima made a mistake, in fact, it's for me a reconnaissance to Elon Lima, because he makes many, many very things for mathematics. And so it's more positive than negative. What I want to say, okay? Okay, so let's go. What we will do is to prove a theorem, which is the following theorem. If you take a triangulated polygon in the plane, okay, which is homeomorphic to a disk, okay, no hole inside, and it is triangulated, but with possible identifications of the boundary. I am sure some of you already think of the classical planar representation of the torus as a square, and you identify these two sides, and you identify these two sides. Okay, this is exactly an example of this. You have a polygon, which is homeomorphic to the disk, and with possible identification of simplices which are in the boundary. No identification inside, only identification of the boundary. Then, using only the Cauchy method, we will show that the Euler characteristic of the full triangulated polygon is the Euler characteristic of the boundary, taking into account identification, of course, plus one. I am sure also some of you already have a proof of this. K0 is a boundary. Boundary. Oh, it's missing here. Thank you. Boundary K0. Okay, thank you. So K0 is a boundary. And I am sure some of you have already a proof of this, but using homotopy or homology or things like that. But we want to use only the Cauchy method. That's the point. Only the Cauchy method. Nothing else. In fact, not. To tell the truth, we use one thing. One thing here. I don't know if it was known in Brazil. This was used by my grandmother and grandmother to dry the salad. When you wash the salad, and then you put in this basket, and you make this like this to take the water out of the basket. And when I was young, my grandmother asked me many times to dry the salad with this kind of basket, which does not exist anymore. And now you have this machine turning to dry the salad, but at that time it was like that. And I will show you at the end of the lecture why this is here. And also, it can be also imagined as this fisherman network in Vietnam. So we will use this, not only the Cauchy method. We will use also subtriangulations, and it seems at the time of Cauchy they did not think of triangulations, of subtriangulations. We will use subtriangulations, I recognize, and a lemma. The lemma is now here. The lemma is the following. If you take sigma, here, sigma is a two-dimensional simplex, which is a triangle. And if you divide this triangle with a segment, tau, you can define a subtriangulation of your triangulation, of your original triangulation, and such that this number does not change. And this is very easy. You know very well that you do simply here. You have to add this as a vertex. This will be an edge, and this also will be an edge. And it's clear that the alternative sum is the same, because here on this segment, you add a vertex, and you add also an edge, because there was one, now there are two. So 1 minus 1 is 0. And inside the triangles, here and here, you divide in two triangles. So you have now two triangles instead of one. And you have now one edge more, so the alternative sum is the same. And the same thing here, if you had inside sigma, if you had such a segment, you can define a subtriangulation compatible with this segment, such that alternative sum is the same. Well, I don't want to spend a lot of time. It's very easy to verify, and you can verify. Okay, the alternative sum is the same. So if you subtriangle, subtriangle your polygon, your alternative sum is the same. Well, so now go to the proof of the theorem. Here is K, our polygon, homeomorphic to a disk. There is a boundary, K0, here. And what shall we do? Here is a basket, salad basket, which arises. What shall we do? We will not stay in the plane. That's a hint. We will go up. We will lift this figure. We will lift. So we choose one triangle. We choose one triangle. And we lift all. We will lift the triangle. And the rest will follow. The basis stay at the basis stage. Okay? The boundary stays at the basis stage. So you take your triangle and you make like this. Okay? Of course, the vertices, for example, here I have a vertex, it will come here. Here I have a vertex, it will come here. I did not do a complicated figure in order to understand, but you see that each vertex will go up, and this one will go up. So you see that all the picture is going on with the lifting of your triangle. And what is interesting to see is that this point, x1, is higher in altitude, I will say, because it is closer to the triangle. The closer vertices to the triangle goes higher. And the vertices which are far from the triangle, which are near the boundary, they go lowest altitude. Okay? So you have this. So you have such a picture, which we call the pyramid, and we will work with this pyramid. Okay? So it's not complicated. Very easy, it's very easy. It's for people, even in master, you can understand. Okay, so you have your pyramid. What do? You take planes, horizontal planes, parallel to the basis planes, going through each vertex. So you have a plane going through x1, p1, plane going to x2, p2, and I put dots to show that you can have how many you want. Okay, if you have more. Okay, so you take these planes. And what will you do? You will cut the pyramid by these planes. Okay, so you obtain points, okay, and you obtain also edges. So cutting the pyramid by these planes, you obtain edges, red or blue edges, and they divide the triangles of the pyramid in the same way than in the lemma. So you can define a sub-triangulation of the original triangulation of the pyramid with the same number, n0 minus n1 plus n2, using the lemma. Okay? In fact, for example, here I have a triangle, it's okay, but here I have now a quadrilateral. And as in the lemma, I can divide this quadrilateral in two triangles. And it's clear that dividing this quadrilateral in two triangles does not change n0 minus n1 plus n2. And you continue, here you have also another quadrilateral. I recognize that this is not very good, my picture, because this should be parallel to this. But sorry, using tick Z is not always easy. And because the two planes are parallel. So you divide here also in two. The sum, alternative sum, does not change. And you continue. You do the same for all of them, for all quadrilateral in front, but also all quadrilateral, which are aside. Okay, so you have now And now you have a full triangulation, which is a sub-triangulation of the original triangulation. And using the lemma, you know that alternative sum is the same. You did not change. Okay? So we will work with this now. What we will do? We will remove a triangle, as is doing Cauchy. We'll remove a triangle. And then we will have a hole, and we will extend the hole on the pyramid. But what we will do, we will not go like that. We will do stage by stage. We will extend the hole from the plane P, there, P dot, to P1, and then P1 to P2, and then papa. And it's necessary to show that at each stage, when you go down like that, you don't change the alternative sum, N0 minus N1 plus N2. Okay? And if you show that, you will go till the boundary. And this will give you the theorem, because Euler characteristic of K will be Euler characteristic of the boundary, K0, K dot, plus one, the triangle you take at the beginning, you remove at the beginning. Okay? So if you can show that at each stage, extending the hole does not change the alternative sum, you win. And this you will do with Cauchy. Cauchy arrives. And in fact, I put here, for example, this is, I have to show. In fact, it's not so difficult to see that, to show that at each stage you have a circle. This is quite easy to show, to see that at each stage you have a circle and you have a band. Okay, you have a band, you have two circles, and you have a band between the two circles. And I want to show that if I extend a hole from the top to the next one, I don't change the alternative sum. So what you do, for example, you choose here is the boundary for pi, the boundary of the hole for pi, bi is the boundary, and so you add to this hole, which is here. I did not put color, it's so pity, but the hole is up, okay, and you want to extend the hole till here. So you can extend with this triangle using operation one by Cauchy, still operation one, now it will be operation two because you have two which are already in the hole, operation two and so on, and you turn always with operation one and two. And you arrive here, you have to take care when you arrive, when after the turn, what happens. And what happens, you have still operation one, and now operation two, and that's it. And so, using only the two Cauchy operations, you can go from one stage to the following stage. This is very important. And you don't use anything else. Of course, what I am doing here is avoiding situation where I will disconnect the hole. I will never disconnect the hole. And the controversy by Lakatos and by Alan Lima was, if you disconnect the hole, you are lost. But here, we show that it is possible to prove without disconnecting the hole. Okay? So now we are, you extend the hole till here, and so on, and so on, and so on. You go to the basis which is K0, K dot, okay? And as I said, Euler characteristic of the full polygon will be the Euler characteristic of the basis. Remind that the basis, it can be some identification. We will see in the later, okay? And you have plus one, which is a triangle at the beginning. So I ask you, if you have already seen that, please tell me, because I look at a lot of books or proofs of Euler formula. I never seen this way to prove Euler formula. I never seen any proof that Euler formula for the torus, for example, can be proved the characteristics of the torus can be proved for any triangulation of the torus. People use classical triangulation of the torus. The same for the... And what we prove here is that for any triangulation of the torus, Euler characteristic is zero. For any. And using only the Cauchy method. Nothing of homotopy. I like homotopy. I like homology. But here, there is absolutely nothing of homotopy and homology. OK, so let's go. The sphere. What shall we do? So take the sphere here and take any triangulation of the sphere. Okay? Assume that you have a triangulation, any triangulation of the sphere, the like, the one you like most. And then I take equator and I take two half meridians, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3. Using the lemma, you can provide a sub-triangulation of the original one that you have chosen, compatible with these curves. And that does not change, you have seen that by the lemma, that does not change the alternative sum. You are allowed to take sub-triangulation compatible with such curves, okay? Okay, so now what you do, you take your scissors and you cut. You cut like orange or I don't know what typical fruits will be here. And you cut, for example, gamma 1, up. Gamma 1 will be here and here, okay? Gamma 2, here, and gamma 3, here and here. So you cut and you separate. Not clear? It's clear? So the North Pole appear on each of them. And you can project this on a plane, which gives you a planar representation of the sphere, which is the very well-known triangle with identifications. And let's go here. So you see here. So you have gamma 1 is here and here, because you separate. Gamma 2 is here and here, and gamma 3 here and here. So you have now a polygon, which is homeomorphic to a disk, and such that there are identification of the boundary. Because you have, in order to recover the sphere, you have to identify this with this, this with this, this with this, and you have to identify the three vertices. Okay? So I have exactly the situation of the theorem. And I do that for any triangulations. I did not put here inside any triangulation because if I do that, you will not see anything. But you can imagine any triangulation here. This is for any triangulation. I insist very well. Okay? And so now you can count. And it's easy to see that on the boundary, you have three vertices here. One, two, three. And you have... And you see 1, 2, 3, which are identified, sorry, it is only one. And then here, you see that you have on each edge the same number of vertices than the same number of edges. And this for any triangulation that you do, you will have always the same number of vertices as edges. So N0 minus N1 is zero. And what is the Euler characteristic of the boundary? It's one. It's one because we have only one vertex. The rest gives zero. So Euler characteristic of the boundary is one. Don't forget that the theorem says that Euler characteristic of K is Euler characteristic of the boundary plus one. So Euler characteristic of the sphere is Euler characteristic of the boundary one plus one. 1 plus 1, everybody knows this too. So this is an elementary proof of the Euler formula for the sphere using only the Cauchy method. Sub-triangulation, if you want to be... not to be, to be shy with me. But we use only the Cauchy method to prove that. Okay? Okay, so this is exactly what I said now. Another way, you can also, if you wish, if you prefer, historical way was using the stereographic projection. Okay? Using the stereographic, projection, what you do? What you do? You dilate, you remove one triangle, ABC, here, containing the North Pole, and you project on the plane, and for example, here on the plane containing the South Pole, but it can be also a plane by equator if you wish, if you prefer, and you project the sphere, which will be inside, the projection of the sphere will be inside this triangle. Okay? So now, in P, in the plane P, you have a triangle, which is homeomorphic to a disk, and there is no identification of the boundary, because these three edges are different here, PA, PB. So you have here a triangle, no identification of the boundary. Well, you know very well that the Euler characteristic will be 1. That is clear, okay, of the boundary here. What I say. What is Euler characteristic of the boundary? You have three vertices, three edges. So it is 0. Okay, N0 minus N1 plus N2 is 0. Okay, so what is Euler? Euler characteristic of the boundary is 0. So Euler characteristic of this part of the sphere is 0 plus 1 by the theorem. Okay, and as you deleted one triangle at the beginning, 1 plus 1 is 2. And another way to see the result. Okay? Anyway, we'll give the same result now if you always use the theorem. Let's go to the torus. And the torus, if I don't mistake, it's the first time you can show that for any triangulation of the torus, then you have using only the Cauchy method always. Okay, so you take a torus, you take a meridian and a parallel. I did not make the picture of the parallel, but you take a blue parallel, for example, going here. And you take your original triangulation, you take any triangulation of the torus, the one you prefer, any triangulation of the torus. And you can, for any triangle, for example, new triangulation, you can subdivide this triangle in order to have now compatibility with the meridian and also with the parallel. And as you know, you take your scissors and you cut along the meridian, you cut along, no, this is the parallel. You cut along the parallel and you cut along the meridian. Okay? And then you have this picture that you know very well, but you know very well with the classical triangulation. Here you take any triangulation, I took any triangulation of the torus, not the classical one, not at all. The theorem says us, the theorem says us that Euler characteristic here of the torus is equal to Euler characteristic of the boundary, K0, plus 1. What is Euler characteristic of the boundary? If everybody will be different, A, it will be you will be 0 as well. But you have the same A. So Euler characteristic of this is minus 1. Okay? Euler characteristic of the boundary is minus 1. And the theorem tells you that Euler characteristic of the torus is minus 1. Euler characteristic of the boundary, plus 1. And you know that is 0. Okay? And so this is a proof answering, is the referee of our paper here? Because this is, it was you? Because this is a proof that you can show using only the Cauchy method that for any triangulation of the torus, you have 0. Much more, take the torus of genus G. I put the picture for 2, for G is 2 and G is 3, and you make the same. What do you do? Instead of taking parallels and meridians, you take generalized parallel on meridians for each hole. Here is for 2, here is for 3. I like this picture. Here is for 3. And so you take parallels on meridians, and you cut, and you cut, and you obtain these pictures here, and you count, and you find a layer characteristic of the torus of genus G. That means that for any surface, orientable surface, Cauchy method applies. Okay? And this is a very, very nice picture. When I was when I was still at school, I don't know why I have seen these pictures. This picture, and I asked my mother, and I cut, and I made a draw. You say drawing. So I made the contrary. Instead of cutting, I make the picture. So I have still a torus with 2 holes that I made by myself. Okay, so you can do for genus 2 and 3. And the projective plane. Go to the projective plane now. Why not? Projective plane is not orientable. But what is a projective plane? You can represent the projective planes at straight line going through the origin in R3. So you can represent, you can take a sphere and you identify opposite points, you know very well, on the sphere. And this gives you the projective plane. Okay? So you take any triangulation of the projective plane. Take care that if you take any triangulation of the projective plane, you have to take a triangulation which is symmetric relatively to the center. Okay? For example, here I picture this triangle which are symmetric relatively to the origin of the sphere. Okay? And then you take the equator. And what we will do is taking only the half, the hemisphere, north hemisphere. You don't need the south hemisphere because it's symmetric. But on the equator, you know very well, you have to identify opposite points. Okay, so here you have the north hemisphere, and you identify this point on the red and this point on the blue. So you obtain that you know very well as well, a planar representation of the projective plane by this way with identification of the boundary. This is identified with this, symmetric relatively to origin, and this is symmetric to this. But now you have points A and B. And it is very easy to see that in now, a layer characteristic of the boundary, you know very well, is 0 of the boundary. So a layer characteristic of the projective plane is 1. Using only Cauchy method, I insist. Okay? For any triangulation. Why not the Klein bottle? So you make the same than for the torus. You choose what I will call parallel red on the meridian blue on the Klein bottle, and you cut the Klein bottle. And then you have the planar representation of the Klein bottle that you know very well. And you say, you know very well how to do. And you compute a layer characteristic of the boundary, which is minus 1, because you have the same vertices here, the same, okay? So it is the same than the torus, in fact. And so the layer characteristic of the Klein bottle is 0 for any triangulation of the Klein bottle, always using only the Cauchy method. Thank you.